So if we have somebody on a clear liquid diet, it's usually because they've got really bad diarrhea or some major problem with their stomach. Now, when somebody eats anything at all, no matter what it is, it literally goes to the stomach and turns into a liquid called chyme. Okay? And meat, bread, whatever, it turns into chyme. And then, of course, what happens is it leaves the stomach, and this is a little bit of an oversimplification, but it goes through the small intestine very slowly, and then, of course, it goes through the large intestine, and then finally comes out the rectum. Well, what this chyme is doing is it slowly moves through the gut, is all these six essential nutrients are being reabsorbed. The protein, the carbs, the fats, the vitamins, the minerals, the water. They're virtually being reabsorbed. Well, if somebody has a really bad stomach virus, now you gotta remember the stomach works terribly hard to turn the solid food into chyme. It's hard work, okay? Well, if something's wrong with the stomach, like have you ever been playing a game and you did something wrong and it tilted and you had to hit the reset button? Or like on your computer, something messed up and you had to reboot your computer? What a clear liquid diet does is it resets the stomach. It's like hitting the reset button or hitting the reboot button, because the liquid will basically bypass the stomach, because what the stomach does is what? Turns the solid into liquids. Well, if it's already liquids, the stomach don't have to work. So it kind of bypasses the stomach. So it allows the stomach to rest. And that's exactly what we're doing with a clear liquid diet. We are allowing the stomach to literally rest. A clear liquid, like I said, is short term. There's not these six essential nutrients. Of the six, there's only one they're really getting good, and that's water. They're not getting a lot of protein, carbs, fats, vitamins, or minerals until today. Nestle's has come up with a clear liquid, full nutritional diet that is literally clear liquid. It's like it has 500 calories, and it is well balanced with proteins, carbs, vitamins, minerals, fats. Because all what we were doing before was this person, they were sick already, and then we were starving them on top of that. Yeah.
Why isn't enzymes in the nutrition?
Why is it enzymes?
Yeah.
They're like, what enzymes particular?
Electrolytes.
A lot of them are. Sodium, potassium.
Yeah.
See, those are your electrolytes. So they're classed in basically with your minerals. So yeah, there are enzymes, those, you know, sodium, potassium, bicarb, yeah. But the two big ones, like I said, were sodium and potassium because of what they do for the heart. So when Plato said, food is our medicine, medicine is our food, how many thousand years ago, he was ahead of his time, because in our foods basically is all these things that we need, and it's remarkable. It's remarkable what can happen to a person if their diet is changed, because an elderly person can literally be turned into a very confused person if their diet has changed and they're not getting the nutrients that they need. So what a liquid diet does, like I said, is it bypasses the stomach because it's already liquid, so it doesn't make the stomach work. It gives it a little time to rest and basically recover. But for all intents and purposes, it's only meant to be short term. Now, This next one's not in your book, but I'm going to put it in there. It's called a full liquid diet. And basically,
it's a what?
Full liquid diet.
Oh, no, they have it in there.
They do?
Mm-hmm.
Where?
Clear or full. A clear liquid consists of fluids that you can see through such as clear skin and uses.
Okay, they don't have I was looking for a whole section on it.
Oh.
But they, yeah. So, and what a full liquid diet is, okay, if somebody has been on a clear liquid diet for a couple days because of an upset stomach, we don't want to take them and boom, put them back on regular food. So a full liquid diet is going to have like your cream soups in it and puddings. It's still going to be liquidy, but it's going to be a little bit fuller consistency, more like I said, the cream stuff. So basically what it does is it allows the person to go from liquid to progress slowly back, from clear liquid to full liquid to progress slowly back to their regular meal. Because the stomach's been resting for a couple days on this clear liquid, and if we hit them with the full liquid, it could overwhelm them and the very diarrhea could start right back up again. So the full liquid diet helps. Now, the soft diet and the mechanical soft diet are basically the same. Now, there's two major reasons for a soft diet. One of it is it's soft on the jaw or the mouth, the whole mouth, and it's soft on the stomach. A lot of our elderly have arthritis in their jaws, they have loose teeth, they have cavities, they have chipped teeth, they have a lot of different pain issues in their mouth. So the soft diet is easier on the mouth. And it is also easier on the stomach. Now it's not like a full liquid diet that passes the stomach, but it still does not make the stomach work as hard because it's a softer consistency than a regular diet. So it's soft on the jaw and it's soft on the stomach. Well, not the whole jaw, like I said, the whole mouth. And it just is easier. Now, one of the softest diets of all is the pureed diet. Now, if somebody really has real trouble chewing and because of tremendous problems in their mouth or tremendous problems in their stomach, the pureed diet is the next one. Now, and of course, all the pureed diet is whatever they're cooking. They don't change it at all. They just take it and put it in the blender. So really, it should taste no different. But our mind says, a hamburger to me needs to look like this. The hamburger patty, two slices of bread or whatever, and da da da. It does. A hamburger is not a brown liquid in a bowl. But really, all they do is they take it off the grill, put it in the blender. So it shouldn't, they've not made it weird. You know what I mean? Now, like the cookies that we had, they'll just take the cookies, put them in the blender. Now they may add a little bit of milk to them, okay? But that should not, because most people dunk anyways, don't they? You know, at least I believe they should. The same with the cereal. Like say we would have had oatmeal today. Oatmeal can be kind of chunky. They'll blend it up, puree it up. They have it. Nothing's been done different to it. So pureed is simply food that's really been super blended into like the paste consistency of baby food. But you know, our mind is used to a certain way, and it just can't accept, like, a tomato. If you really like tomatoes, all you do is put them in a blender, take them like soup. But you're used to a tomato being in your hand like this, and that's what your mind expects. Like, if you like a certain type of pie, Now, like, and say you just drink one type of pop only, okay? And you're sitting there, and somebody comes up and say it's Coke, and somebody comes up and switches your Coke and puts a Dr. Pepper. Has anybody ever done that to you? And then you take a drink of it, and there's a jolt. You know, there's a little shocking jolt. Now, the Dr. Pepper, hey guys, you're not hearing me back. The Dr. Pepper tasted okay, but the thing is, your mind was ready for a Coke, so the Dr. Pepper shocked you. Well, it's the same thing with the mind here. It's ready for a certain type of consistency. Food looks a certain way. It's looked this way for 85 years of their life, and now it's in a bowl. So a lot of people refuse to eat it. And that's when all of a sudden, you guys have somehow got to get creative. This is where the creativity of the CNA comes in, because, you know, we know they have to eat, you know? So what can you do to basically help them to eat something that they hate? And there is no easy answer to that. It's all individual, because one thing that may work on one resident may not work on another. Okay, a bland diet. A bland diet, low spice. Now, how many of you 10 or 15 years ago ate spicy foods and it didn't bother you, but you eat the same spicy food today and it bothers you a little bit with heartburn? Anybody? One, two, or three? Okay. This is what's going on. Your stomach, our stomachs, have an incredibly thick, whoops, wrong one again. Son of a gun. I did it again. Okay, what got it off the other day?
Clorox
or alcohol?
Clorox.
Our stomachs, I knew I should have put that pin over there. Got to get it far away from me. Our stomachs have a lining that's incredibly thick. But as we age, it starts to get smaller and smaller, and it is just not as thick as it used to be. So as this lining in our stomach starts to virtually get thinner and thinner and thinner as we age, it exposes more nerves, and that's why the spicy foods that we used to be able to eat that never, ever, ever bothered us, all of a sudden now really can start to bother us. So the elderly, you know, if we're in our 30s or 40s or 50s or whatever, we got to remember the elderly have many more years on us than that. So their stomach has even gotten thinner, the lining, that protective lining. So the spicy foods, the foods like that will give them more heartburn because of the thinning of this. And that's where a lot of your residents are going to have heartburn. Some of the things that they'll talk about, one thing, come on, that ain't bad. One thing that they'll talk about is GERDs a lot. Sometimes what you can do to help them with their heartburn is elevate the head of their bed a little bit so the acid reflux doesn't come up as high and distress them. Some people may ask for a glass of milk to dilute it down. Sometimes a half a piece of bread or a piece of bread will help them, because that will absorb the extra hydrochloric acid. So there's a few things that we can basically do, and of course one of the big ones is to make sure that they get a bland diet, a diet that is not so spicy that will upset them and basically hurt them so much. The citrus juices, the citrus fluids, they have a lot of acid in them and could really cause them some distress. Now, the diet that's high residue or high fiber. High residue, high fiber diets retain fluid. So basically, if somebody eats a high residue diet and here comes this chyme, and of course, as it works its way through the small, then the large intestine, that's of course where the BM is being formed. Okay? Well, as a person is doing that, if they have a high residue, high fiber diet, the fiber is going to be in their gut retaining a little bit more fluid. The end result, what is hoped is the end result, then is because the BM has more fiber in it, that means more water in it, that means not so much constipation. So it's a high fiber diet is basically for the folks that do have the constipation problems. Low residue, low fiber diets, of course, is for the res that just have the opposite, have too loose of stools. Modified calorie diets, of course, that just, you probably know what that is, that's if you know, a person's trying to either change their weight, either gain weight or lose weight. Most of the time, your residents, you're going to be working with them to get more calories in, to gain weight. Now, sometimes it's almost better to give the resident 6 smaller meals a day than 3 big ones. Because have you ever been somewhere at a restaurant, at a friend's house, and they brought you a plate and it was heaping full? They sat it down in front of you, and all of a sudden your appetite was gone. It was almost too overwhelming. Well, you know, here again, let's go back to our resident. After we scratched off those things on our list, they've been living alone for 10 years. They've been eating not a whole lot of that pyramid that you saw, the color pyramid, the grains, the meats, all that, the beans. They've not been eating a lot of that. So here we come and set this tray in front of them. To us, it looks normal. But to them, it's just overwhelming. And I can't eat that. So it'd be better to bring them something smaller that they would eat, not overwhelm them. So what comes now is the snack cart. 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 or 3 in the afternoon, and then bedtime. Now a snack cart and different places, and literally it'll be like a meal on wheels, you know? It'll have donuts on it and cakes on it, but it also will have fruits, they'll have protein bars on it, they will have vegetable sticks on it. It'll be a rolling diner almost. And so the residents go up and they help themselves. And so they're getting a brunch and then a lunch and then, you know, so they're not getting so overwhelmed. And for a lot of people, it does help them.
That speeds up your metabolism too.
Huh?
That speeds your metabolism up also.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And of course, with the elderly, metabolism being low and slow is an issue. Low sodium diets, of course. Now, what I said about the diuretic, remember? You know, how the diuretic works is it pulls sodium out of the body and water follows sodium. Well, if sodium stays in the body, they're going to retain water. So like a cardiac patient, a heart patient, could be on a low sodium diet because if they have extra water in them. Now, I don't know if any of you have high blood pressure, but a lot of people that have high blood pressure basically have to be on a low sodium diet. And because here again, water follows sodium. High protein diet, okay, well, if protein heals tissue, well, you can imagine who's going to be on our high protein diet. Could be our person with a decubitus ulcer, a skin wound for healing. Now, if they're really on a need for a high protein diet, one of the things that a lot of times we're going to do is they're going to get these shakes. Carnation Instant Breakfast, Resource, Ensure, whatever. They're going to get these maybe at meal time, or maybe they're going to get them on the snack cart. And they're going to come out, the glass will be there, they'll have a piece of cellophane on it with their name on it. Okay, when that happens, that's particularly for them. And what's trying to happen is to give them these extra calories, this extra protein, because either they're losing weight, or they need the protein to heal, or something like that. Low protein diets, the only time I've really seen a low protein diet is somebody who's actively taking kidney dialysis. Because now you know the one in our, I just went blank on her name, but
Shanna.
Yeah, her little one is 18 months old, and she talks about it commonly, so I'm not breaking any confidentiality that her baby's now on the renal transplant list and for kidney, and I guess she has now found out she's a perfect match. Mm-hmm. So I told her, if you need to break from class for your kid, you do it. You know, don't prioritize the class over the kid. But anyways, she has to watch incredibly how much protein he eats, how much sodium he gets, how much potassium's in the food, how much phosphorus is in the food. So basically what she is she is one super label reader. Of all the diets, probably the strictest is a renal diet, because the amount of protein they get has to be very limited, because the kidneys, it's the easiest way to explain it is they jam up. The protein, the phosphorus, the potassium, cholesterol, all these things just jam up the kidneys worse and just make them not work at all. So you have to really limit basically how much they eat. So a low protein diet, the only ones that I've ever seen on a low protein are the people that are on, you know, kidney dialysis. Low fat, low cholesterol, of course. Cholesterol is, you know, there are two major types of clots that are in our body that if they get stuck in our brain, they cause a stroke. If they get stuck in our heart, they cause a heart attack. And there are two major clots. One of them, of course, is blood clots.